Back to the Celestial Invitational. I'm D2. With me is Kaldi. We've had an amazing set of series so far with a lot of 3-0s in the round of 8. And obviously we had Tom and Live Coach finally make it out to the finals. I want to remind you guys that if you are missing some of these matches, you can go to my channel at youtube.com/C2AHS to catch some of the action and those VODs. I also want to thank TempleStorm for allowing us to stream on their channel and get this to as many people as possible. Hope you guys are enjoying it thus far. Are you enjoying it, Kaldi, as we look at these decks from Life Coach?
Absolutely. Here we've had Tom here coming in, beating every single Chinese player he's been up against. He beat Chao Shen, Shadow Wei, Braros, Jaysha, but he is yet to beat a Western player in this tournament. He's only played Colento and lost 3-2, whereas Life Coach has beaten Colento in this last series here. And now Life Coach, kind of the king of 3-1. He's won every single series he's played 3-1. Every single one of his wins, I would say, both Blue Eloise and Colento. He's coming here into this final here with what would be Warlock Druid Rogue against Tom's Mage Hunter Rogue. Neither of them have Shaman. Both of them have already had their Shaman wins. They both have a rogue, and that's maybe a weak point for both of them. It'll be interesting to see. I kind of like this lineup, but to talk about Tom, it's going to be the Face Hunter, the Reno Freeze Mage, and the what looks to be the Oil Rogue here. A lot of control, a lot of anti-aggro. This is as anti-aggro as it gets, because we talk about even Face Hunter is anti-aggro, because there's the double unleash, the double explosive trap that just messes up everything with low health. So it'll be interesting to see how that deals with what Life Coach has. But on the flip side, though, yeah, Life Coach with that Warlock, Druid, and Rogue. To talk about the cards, though, Reno Jackson, the Freeze Mage, can be very important. But yeah, Life Coach is actually in Austria or Germany, I believe, whereas Tom here is in the studio in China, flew out. So a lot of respect to him. He looks really calm and ready here for this final. The winner takes home a whopping $10,000, whereas the loser is guaranteed at least $5,000 here. So be interested to see a lot on the line. This would be Tom's third championship now in less than 6 months.
Yeah, extremely crazy run that Tom60229 has been these past few months here. Able to get 2 victories at LANs, and this would be his third if he's able to take out Life Coach. Completely, just a stark contrast to the beginning when he was qualifying for a lot of these events but wasn't able to advance, you know, very deep into them. You know, like we saw earlier at DreamHack, his very first big tournament was at BlizzCon 2014. Wasn't able to get out of the round of 16 in that situation. So really cool to see him completely on a roll and just winning almost everything that he's entering these days. One thing to talk about with these lineups is that neither Tom nor Life Coach has a heal bot in their rogue. They both are deciding to run the Sludge Belcher instead. So it'll be very interesting to see how they hold off some of the aggression. And even obviously the Face Hunter will be something to be worried about for the rogue in this situation, but also the Druid right now that we see Tom face off against. I mean, Life Coach, if he does get Tom in that combo range, the only thing to hold that sort of aggression off from Tom's point of view will only be the Lothib and the Sludge Belcher in his deck.
You talk about a bit about the heal button rogue now. That is something that Firebat and the Archon boys really pioneered, and the idea is, okay, you have a heal bot, you're able to be a little bit more greedy and get more value out of your Blade Flurry, as you can wait a turn more, let your opponent overextend, and it's been proving to be sometimes good in some matchups and weak in others, weak especially against Warrior. That's a big problem. But I mean, Firebat was in the tournament and he lost on his rogue, so maybe that is a bit outdated. He obviously was playing double heal, but it was the Mill Rogue though, whereas both Life Coach and Tom are playing the Oil Rogue. But for this first matchup though, now the strongest rogues in the world have been slightly favored against Druid, but there's very few players that can really get to that level of consistency, and it also depends heavily on the draw, Violet is being a key card. I actually haven't heard of Life Coach or Tom bringing Rogue to a tournament before, so I'm wondering if this is a class that they are actually comfortable with.
Yeah, absolutely. Life Coach, obviously, he was known toward the end of the patron's heyday there. Obviously, it's come back a bit these days, but Life Coach known for being a patron player, which is a combo deck, but obviously not playing Freeze Mage too much or the Oil Rogue, which are the other two most prominent combo decks out there. And we will see how Life Coach does, but in the meantime, we have Tom on the other hand piloting this Oil Rogue. Does have the SI7 agent for that turn three play, wanting to pick up a four drop to follow that up in the following turn. Life Coach, as is customary for him, roping on turn one, wanting to fully think about what he wants to go with, especially with the Innervate Shade possibility on turn one. It can be pretty weak against Rogue if you do go for that option because of the Blade Flurry on later turns. And we now see that he has the option to either go for Drew the Claw here or to go for the Shade. Elects to go for the Shade, thinking that maybe the Drew the Claw could get sapped back, so that could be an issue as we see the Sludge Belcher come into the hand of Tom, but kind of not really wants to see right now. It already has 2 5 drops to kind of choose from. So looks like you're probably gonna see the naked SI7 agent out into the field, and probably going to see ramp into the Drew of the Claw, though that would leave Life Coach with a few options going forward. Though we just pick up the Sludge Belcher.
The thing is, if you go through the claw, it'll be very vulnerable to deadly poison and flurry. That'll be a 3 for 2 trade for life, because giving up the innervate, the shade, and the root of the claw, not something he wants to do. Also, it's only 3 mana because the hero power is automatic on turn two here for Tom. But yeah, with no 4-drop, I kind of feel like Tom isn't looking too good here.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, nothing really to do in this following turn after here. And gonna be interesting to see if Life Coach does go and take that risk and go for either the Sludge Belcher or the Drew of the Claw. Like you said, both are pretty vulnerable to that Blade Flurry. And looks like he's gonna go for that risk, realizing, I mean, Blade Flurry isn't something you want to keep in your opening hand as the Rogue. Want to keep minions that can stick to the board and provide you some resistance. If your opponent's playing one minion at a time, obviously not Blade Flurry is not always going to get that value. So it can be risky for the Rogue to keep that, and Life Coach recognizing at this moment. And we see Tom does pick up the Eviscerate, but nothing to combo with it other than that Blade Flurry. So going to be a pretty dead card at the moment. I mean, the best he can do here is kind of clear off. Oh, he's going to go for it. Wow. Going to go for the Temple play here and just get rid of this Sludge Belcher right away.
That's so aggressive. He gives up a weapon, he gives up both the Blade Flurry and the Eviscerate. I mean, maybe that's what he had to do, but he could have also just cleared it with the fan and the weapon, drawn extra card, kept both the Flurry and the Eviscerate. This is excessively aggressive from Tom. I'm not sure I like this. What do you think?
I mean, sometimes that's what you have to do as the rogue. I mean, we've seen the statistics out there, even though a lot of rogue players like to think that the rogue is the more favored class in the situation. The druid statistically is more favored because of its crazy turns that it can accomplish with that innervate. We do see that excuse me, Life Coach has picked up the Wild Growth, and that could be pretty huge here. Does go for the Wrath for 3 rather than going for the Wrath for 1 and picking up a card there. So going to be able to ramp up into his 7 drops a turn early. Obviously already has the Druid of the Claw for next turn. But yeah, going back to what we were talking about a second ago, Tom, I mean, realizing he needs as much tempo as he can and realizing that his next turn and potentially his next 2 turns are going to be very clunky considering he has all 5 drops in hand. So I can kind of respect that he's taking that huge risk and playing that out. But Life Coach, on the other hand, puts on the aggression, realizing that this could very well be what Tom wants to do. Wants to get a 5-drop out here and going to be unable to deal with this shade. What an amazing play by Life Coach here.
Yeah, very important read here from Life Coach. Really impressive, and he's gonna be paid off. It's gonna pay off big time. I mean, this could have been horrible if he had something like a deadly poison, but I mean, Life Coach knows that there isn't a deadly poison in the hand, because why wouldn't Tom have gone for it on the turn that he went for the Blade Flurry there? But yeah, to mention about the Druid versus Rogue, there's a few things that need to come together for that to happen, for the Rogue to be favored. The Rogue has to be played perfectly. It needs at least an average hand, and that involves a few things. One of them being having, generally, it's way better to have the coin. You need the prep sap, that's very important. And a vial teacher is also very important. You could possibly get away with just having the get away with just having the sweater, but the Vileplume is just so much better. Now, what can Tom really do? I mean, Fan Eviscerate seems so horrible, and if Life Coach has the option of going for a Dr. Boom next turn, this may be, yeah, situation that Tom can't recover from, because you can't really sap something like Dr. Boom.
Yeah, definitely the case here. I mean, I wonder if Tom just goes for the sap on this Shade, because the Shade represents so much more than 3 mana at this point. You really don't want to be, you know, developing that later on as Life Coach, but I want to go back to Life Coach's previous turn where he used the Force Nature to clear. I mean, if he didn't go for that, he would either have to trade with his Shade or risk it dying to something like Eviscerate, or, you know, trade in his Druid of the Claw. So really heads up play to go for the Force Nature there. A lot of players like to hold on to that for the combo, but he not only gets the damage in, gets the 7 damage to the face on Tom, but also gets tempo here by forcing Tom essentially to clear this Shade out, and Tom is not going to be able to develop anything this turn. Doesn't develop the Lotha, doesn't develop the Sludge Belcher because he's afraid of the damage coming his face, and now Life Coach has a clear board to play the Dr. Boom. Such great play by Life Coach here, and really nothing for Tom to be able to combat this.
Yes, it was gonna be, you know, turn 7 Dr. Boom. I mean, it's almost automatic at this turn. If you have a Dr. Boom in your hand and you have 7 mana, you just kind of go for it. But yeah, think about if Tom on turn 6 had that 4 drop, could have gone, for example, Wild Hitter Sah, Wild Hitter Eviscerate, had to go for a Phantom Knife instead and has an empty board. Now plays just the Belcher and Saps. I mean, Lycos should just probably replay the Dr. Boom, I think.
Yeah, typically that's what you do when you see the rogue go for the sap on the Dr. Boom. Obviously, I mean, sometimes there's occasional situations where the rogue does have the ability to clear the next turn, you know, given enough mana and given the board state. And so that could be something weighing on Life Coach's mind. Maybe he picks up something else. Obviously, we're unable to see his hand at the moment. But we do see that Tom does have the second sap in hand, so that could be something that he could use in the future. However, I mean, leaving Life Coach with 6 boom bots is pretty, you know, threatening and not a good situation to be in as Tom, because he's not too close to lethal here.
Yeah, I mean, there's no Force Nature, no Savage Roar, but the Phantom Knife is pretty strong.
Yeah, that is a pretty good card to see here. And as Tom, maybe you just clear the board here rather than go for the sap again. Obviously, you don't want to be seeing any more boom bots in the future. So we could be seeing a Blood Mage Thalnos plus a backstab and a fan, as well as the Sludge Belcher trading into the Dr. Boom. It's pretty painful, but sometimes it's what you have to do.
He gets 2 draw out of it, and there's the potential of a boom bot hitting the Thalnos. So that's possibly a second draw, but he kind of needs something to follow that up with. I think Elden Ring would probably be the best draw to get, but
right.
Where does he go from there, really? Like, now, finally, he starts to get some value out of this, but oof.
Gonna take a huge risk here and go for the boom bots. There's 4 boom bots here, guys. Let's see what they hit. Hits for 1, 2, 2, 1, 4. I mean, overall, that's pretty expected. I think that's about more or less average. It gets a decent amount of damage to the face and clears off the first half of the Sludge Belcher, so... I mean, I don't think either player can be too sad about that result. It was more or less average.
But the value in this is not that strong. I mean, the Dr. Boom stays alive, so even though he can't really go for the combo because of the Lothep, there's also the potential of him not having combo. And I think Tom has to figure that if Life Coach has the combo, he's already won the game pretty much. So what I think Tom should have done was play around the idea of Life Coach not having the combo at all and the combo not existing, because if in Tom's mind the combo exists, he's just going to lose. So he has to just be as greedy as possible. I think that in this case would have been running the Belcher into the Dr. Boom after the backstab and going for the Phantom Knives with Thalnos.
Right. I think what Tom is going for here in this situation is saving the sap for something else. And, you know, I think his next turn is going to be Dr. Boom into Sap, and he just wanted to kind of isolate the Dr. Boom. I didn't want to go for the kill there, wanted to get the damage from the Lotha going as soon as possible. And I think Tom is looking for a 3-turn kill here by playing that Lotha out right now. And we could see something like a Dr. Boom plus Sap on the Ancient of Lore.
I mean, yeah. What's more valuable for Tom, a fan of knives and Thalnos, or a Lothep, and in my opinion, that has to be the low step has to be more important. So if you can go for the final knives after the downloads into low step, I think that's much stronger in my opinion at least. But yeah, there was no combo. We saw that Life Coach had the Savage Roar. Looks like he probably doesn't have the Force Nature. He used that already, I believe.
Yeah, he used the Force Nature to clear out, what was it, the Azure Drake earlier to be able to, you know, push some more damage with his Shade. And it was a really good tempo turn earlier. So I think Life Coach is fine having used that earlier as a nice tool for removal. But he does have the Swipe, and he also has the Savage Roar, so he's able to clear this. He could actually clear it with his face, surprisingly, if he goes for Swipe Savage Roar and Hero Power, but that would be a bit too much mana to commit to this, I believe. And, I mean, he does have two Ancient Lores in hand as well, so you think he might go for that? No, he's going to go for just being aggressive as possible and just charging this Druid Claw to the face. How much damage is that going to be? It looks like it's going to be 13 damage hitting the face. And yeah, just hitting up for the Swipe the following turn. And this could, I mean, maybe Life Coach just is like has Tom's deck list next to him and he's realizing, wait a second, you don't have any Healbot in here, so I basically just win the game the next turn.
Believe so, yeah. Do you know if he has the Earth Ring though?
Yeah, I think he has the Earth Ring of Forest here, but in this case, as long as Tom doesn't put up a Taunt or Lothab, which you've already seen, the game is pretty much over. I mean, obviously with that Swipe in the hand of Life Coach, he can just swipe in Hero Power here. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that's going to be game. If I remember correctly, Life Coach does have that Swipe in hand. So game one is going to go to Life Coach with that Druid versus Tom's Rogue, as we see right there. The Living Roots just makes it so that Tom could potentially tilt here, but yeah, goes for the top deck right there. And again, Life Coach takes game one, goes up to a 1-0 series, or 1-0 lead in this five game, or this best of five conquest series, sorry about that, and is one step closer to getting that $10,000.
Absolutely, yeah, 7 out into the cast. It's been a long day, also for these players who have been playing all day here and played so many games. But if we look at the situation now, Life Coach has to win with his Warlock and his Rogue, whereas Tom has to deal with all three decks. I feel like it's actually kind of likely that Life Coach is running either Reno Lock or Hunt Lock, and depends a bit on how that goes. I feel like if he's running Warlock, he can actually lose to the Hunter and the Mage.
Yeah, Life Coach is running a very standard demon handlock. So no, you know, Reno craziness there. But it didn't work out too well for him in the group stages. I believe it lost all three of his games, if I remember correctly. So it'll be interesting to see if it can pick up some wins here. In particular, the handlock versus rogue matchup would be pretty interesting. Obviously, that matchup has gone kind of back and forth over the months and even years of its existence, dating back to, you know, when rogue was basically more miracle rogue than oil rogue. And in any case, hopefully we'll see the next game coming up soon. Tom just kind of stretching it out there, getting ready for the next match. It's really kind of insane to see how far Tom has progressed. I mean, I remember playing him at the BlizzCon 2014 World Championships, and I didn't really think of much of him, to be completely honest, and was able to take him out there, and he just really progressed as a player. And just, I mean, even when he took out Kalento in the PAX Championships, the Onog series, over the summer, he was so calm, kind of expected to win at Championships, and even down 0-1 here, not even fretting it, and showing that championship medal here.
Not many people that can actually do that, be confident against Kalento. Yeah, wow. I mean, the thing is that Life Coach is known for the same lineup. He played the exact same lineup for probably 5 or 6 months. So what he would play would be Huntlock, Double Combo Druid, and Mechmage. Over and over and over and over. And then he switched to Patron. Double Combo, Mechmage, and Huntlock. But yeah, he has two of them now. The third is the Rogue. I feel like the Rogue is the key for Life Coach. If he wins with the Rogue, I think he's going to take the whole championship. But yeah, we're looking into going Huntlock against Rogue. That's exactly the matchup that Life Coach needed to hit. I feel like both the Hunter and the Freeze Mage would have a decent chance against the Huntlock. I'm kind of surprised, honestly, that Tom goes for the Rogue here into Rogue and Huntlock. He must know that. I mean, well, wouldn't you want to be looking at the Face Hunter or the Freeze Mage? Because they're both favored against Huntlock and Rogue.
Well, I mean, Looking at the situation, I mean, traditionally the Miracle Rogue wasn't very favored against the Handlock, and even though you had, Miracle Rogue specialists saying like, no, the Miracle Rogue is favored. I mean, if you looked at the matchup and you had the Handlock player play it, correctly, which is to say they didn't play it scare, they put out all their threats on curve and made sure that they, got the win by being aggressive, then it was actually favored for the Handlock. But I mean, recently with this Oil Rogue, I. Looking at some of the statistics, I mean, the Oil Rogue has done a really good job of making it much more in their favor, and in some situations, actually being the favored matchup. And a lot of it comes down to making sure that you keep that tempo up, using your tools like Sap to get that tempo, make sure the Handlock is on the back foot, and even having that sprint, that guaranteed use of the sprint to be able to, refill your hand at the right moments when you've already gained the tempo. And we will see if Tom is able to use those tools that the excuse me, the Rogue has to defeat Life Coach, or if Life Coach can, use his mastery of Handlock to take down this matchup. What do you think here, Kaldi? I mean, we've seen this matchup go back and forth, but I feel like lately just the expert rogue players have this kind of on lockdown.
It's tough to call. I think it's all going to be about the early pressure from the minions. I feel like the traditional Handlock is a little bit stronger than the Demon Handlock, as the traditional Handlock is a little bit has more tools to deal with the threats that Rogue brings. But I mean, on the flip side, though, the Demon Handlock just has more consistency. You always have a four drop because you have two Twilight Drakes, two Mountain Giants, and two Void Callers, so there's always something to play on turn four, turn
Oh,
five, and
wow.
yeah, I mean, Tom is just playing it so aggressively, and that's exactly what he needs to do. Because now he figures, okay, if I face a Mountain Giant or a Twilight Drake, that's great, but the
Big Game
top
Hunter.
deck, Big Game Hunter, oh my god, life goes. This is the second time that this has happened here.
I mean, that's absolutely insane, picking up the Big Game Hunter right at the correct moment. And we saw the card coming from the right side, so yeah, it looks like he's gonna go for that. I can't imagine any other play here, and Tom must be devastated. This is the exact opposite of how this matchup normally plays out usually. And we see a life coach kind of shrug there, saying like, oh, okay, he has the Shredder. But I think he's pretty happy in the situation, only down at 19 health, and considering he was facing such a huge minion the turn before, but he's pretty happy about that.
What I want to see now is Life Coach going for the Mountain Giant and not tapping, because if he taps, the sap will make mean that he'll discard one card actually out of his hand. But if there is no sap from Tom, but it's something you definitely keep in mind if you're a Handlock here, because you don't want to give up the health. It's also important. What I want to see now is just Mountain Giant and end turn. But he is taking some damage from Tom. I mean, the thing is, there's Eviscerate. Tom kind of needs a second Eviscerate to put any pressure on Life Coach, but it's a taunt after, so he could go Mountain Giant, Twilight Drake taunt into a heal bot, and I don't think Tom can actually deal with that.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how Tom utilizes his resources. I imagine Life Coach is either going to go for the Mountain Giant or the Twilight Drake. Goes for the higher health creature here so that he can get better trades onto this pile of the Shredder. But yeah, like you say, it's going to be interesting to see how this plays out. I imagine Tom is not going to go for the sap here. Likely wants to save it for, some sort of giant that's taunted up. So yeah, going to go for the Azure Drake. And I think he's going to attack phase here. Yeah, goes for that. I mean, one of the kind of unwritten rules is that you want to put the Handlock one health lower than their mana total, so they can't, go with the Molten Giant Taunt, and that gets them the lowest health without allowing them to go for some crazy plays.
I guess yeah, Akko's idea is that there might be a Big Game Hunter, but there's definitely no silence. So if you place the Twilight Drake first, then that's going to be just as good, and you can trade into the Azure Drake or the Paladin anyway. But yeah, I expect Life Coach to take his entire turn here. He's probably figuring, okay, can I go for Mountain Giant and Owl, or do I have to go? Do I have to taunt up right now?
Yeah, I imagine he's gonna go for the Mountain Giant plus the taunt. He's getting pretty low in health here, and it's just too much of a risk, I believe, if he weren't to go for that. He also has the healing to go behind it, so yeah, he is going to go for the healing, or excuse me, the taunt right now. and killing the spell damage was pretty important here because otherwise Tom might have been able to use this Blade Flurry to greater effect. Does get the deadly poison. He can now go for 6 damage Blade Flurry. Is that worth it in this situation?
I don't think it is. I mean, he can clear this possibly if he just Blade Flurries and then re-daggers and attacks into
Right.
Twilight Drake. But what is the follow-up there? He could eviscerate phase, but that's painful.
I think he just Blade Flurries and then eviscerates the Mountain Giant, re-daggers, hits the Twilight Drake, and then hits the face with the Shredder and brings his opponent down to what, 7 life? That's pretty pain. That's pretty threatening for Life Coach, and maybe he overreacts.
I like that line of play. That seems really, really strong. I think you're right about that. He also has the sap to follow up, but he may be looking at then just sprinting and nothing else. And what can he then draw? He only has two really viable cards at that point, being the Eviscerate and the second Blade Flurry.
Yeah, but I
Blade
mean,
Flurry.
if he does sprint though, I mean he could pick up his second prep, and that would be a really beneficial tool in order to get back into the game. Looks like Life Coach is a bit concerned. You can see on his face there. And the one benefit also, obviously, Life Coach has a pretty big turn here. He can go for the Molten Giant plus the Healbot to kind of save himself from dying. I mean, he could even go for the Defender of Argus, but obviously, he hasn't seen a single sap, so that'd be very dangerous, obviously. And in fact, we do see he would die to just the deadly poison plus the sap. But the one thing to consider here is that even though Life Coach has a pretty good kind of swing turn in this situation, it's not, absolutely devastating to Tom. So Tom can, I believe, go for that sprint and maybe kind of bring back the tempo in his favor afterward.
Yeah, that is true. The Defender of Arcus is just so critical. I would expect the owl to come down as well for the taunt, but there's maybe the idea of the heal, but I feel like the taunt is more important though. But I mean, there is a possibility that he can just clear this. Toxic
Wow.
Eviscerate and Tom takes this game.
Yeah, any sort of damage here would be lethal here for Tom because he does have that sap. Double deadly poison, I think, is
Not
a
gonna
bit
be enough.
short. Is there any
Yeah.
way? Yeah, I don't think there was any way for him to finagle that there. Looks like he's just gonna go for the sprint. Cannot find the prep, which is crucial here. And now
Yeah, I
Tom.
mean, this couldn't have been worse, honestly, for Tom, how this turned out. I felt like this wasn't an easy choice. I think there was some merit,
Right.
actually, last turn to, or this turn, to sap the Molten deadly and kill the 3-2, go face, put him down to 3 health, and re-dagger and deadly. I felt that there was some merit to that, but I mean, Life Coach does have the heal button, and isn't he just going to be 100% safe at that point?
Yeah, does he go for the tap Healbot here, though? I mean, obviously we need to see his top deck, though we can't see that right now at the moment. But if you do tap and Healbot, you do go up to 13 health, which could keep you safe, especially because from no board, typically Rogue can't do greater than 12 damage. Obviously they can, it's possible, but usually you're going to be seeing the deadly plus Tinkers plus Flurry. And that will be 12 damage along with the sap as well. Obviously, if he has something like Saucy Deckhand, it's pretty dangerous. But I wonder, I mean, we see Life Coach counting right now, going all the way to the rope. Does pick up the Jiraxis, so this, I mean, he kind of has the Healbot here, which is pretty painful for him since he can just heal up the next turn with Jiraxis. But yeah, definitely has to go for it in the end, or else we know he was going to die. A lot of pressure on Tom here. What can he pick up? Gets the Blood Mage Thanos. I don't know if that helps him too much. And I think he's gonna be forced to sap here.
Yeah, it's painful because he can't really effectively push a lot of damage. He could go put him down to 8, but then he'll need Flurry and the Eviscerate to do anything. The thing is, though, Life Coach has, what is it, at least 8 burst damage in hand plus the 5 on board. So, yeah, I mean, he could go up to 14, Tom could, and then he would be one off lethal.
Yeah, that's the
I don't know how
painful
this is
here.
going to go.
That's a painful part here for Tom. I mean, but do you expect a dark bomb and a Doom Guard coming out of Life Coach? I think Tom might play this greedy and not go for the Earthring Farseer here. And if he doesn't, he's going to be dead. As it stands, he has to use 5 out of his 8 mana just to do that. So this is just a really painful situation for Tom.
Yeah, I think it's going to be double deadly face or just Earth Ring and maybe Thalmos even or Redagger.
Wow.
Hopefully, Elden Ring will play to
Really
him.
crazy play by him to go for that. In fact, he's actually going to start clearing, which is really interesting. It seems like Tom realizes that Life Coach is a bit scared for his life total, and Tom can start maybe leveraging the situation into more tempo on his side. Right now, Life Coach, one damage off lethal. Can he pick it up? No, he does not.
The Sun Fury on top of everything. If
Yeah.
Lifecoat's tapped, he can actually go for both giants, can't he? Believe so.
Yeah, if he taps, the Mountain Giant would be 4, then the Molten Giant would be 1, so that would be 5, and then 2 and 2. Yeah, he can tap and go for both and put both onto the field right now. Obviously, it's a bit risky, especially to something like a Blade Flurry. But, I mean, you've seen a lot of those cards already. You've seen Tinkers, you've seen Blade Flurry, and so maybe you just take that risk.
I think it's the way to go. This is really rough. Wait, I guess there is also the possibility of going Mountain Giant, Dark Pommy your own face, Molten Taunt. Maybe not that strong of a play. I mean, you take one damage for no reason, but go to the Mountain and Dark Bomb Taunt. That's not bad either.
Right, yeah, it does get a decent amount of stuff in the way, and the crucial thing here is that you're not allowing Tom to get any sort of, buff onto his minions, and this is, enough pressure as it is onto Tom, and we see him kind of struggling with the situation. No real way out of this. I mean, Azure Drake, both Azure Drake and Sprint, his two options for drawing cards right now, are so expensive, so, I mean, if you go for one of those, it's kind of hard to see him getting out of this turn afterward.
Yes, true. Just surviving is going to be hard enough, but actually taking the win seems impossible at this point. If we look at the best possible card he could have from the sprint, that would probably be not even sap.
Yeah, from Sprint, Sap, maybe he could get Prep, Blade, Flurry, Eviscerate, I believe? Something like that. I guess the double backstab as well as the Flurry. Unfortunately, backstab doesn't work that way anymore. You can't actually kill off the Mountain Giant in this situation. And even if it was the old backstab, I suppose you don't have the spell damage. So that is going to be game. Life Coach has a couple of ways to finish this off. We'll see if it's Draxus or the Doom Guard. I'm actually going to be the Dr. Boom with the Moral Coil
Ooh.
instead. Very
Life
well
Coach just
played.
has some class. I've got to give it to him, honestly.
love to see the Flurry. Even gets the Dark Bomb afterwards, so that's absolutely awesome. And Life Coach is going to take a 2-0 lead, putting it to Tom here, who is in the studio, as you can see. And the only deck left for Life Coach to take this is the Rogue. Can he do it? Can Life Coach pilot 9 different classes to victory? This is so un-Life Coach-like.
Absolutely. I mean, Life Coach has proven that his deck and his strategy works in any meta here. I mean, Huntlock is something we saw before the expansion, but after the expansion, it's just completely fallen out of style. But Life Coach just proves again and again that it doesn't matter. It's still strong. The idea is still solid. And now he only has the Rogue left, but that's going to be his weak point. Can he overcome that here in these next games?
Yeah, it's going to be crucial for him to be able to pilot this as well as he possibly can. Tom gonna go with the most favored matchup first, knowing that Life Coach doesn't have a heal bot in his deck. Looking at it before, he only had the Sludge Belcher to kind of, protect against the Facehunter. And obviously, Facehunter likes to run that Ironbeak Owl, so it could be a point of weakness here for Life Coach. And we will see if he can pull off the upset in this particular match. Obviously, he does have 2 more games after this if he does fall. But this will be interesting to see how these matchups go. Life Coach with a pretty decent hand here, honestly, with the prep fan. That's exactly what you want. Also, kind of curious to see if he will keep that Violet Teacher. Obviously, it's very weak against Unleash the Hounds, but I mean, Unleash the Hounds not something you're ever going to keep as Face Hunter versus the Oil Rogue. So maybe he could take a chance here and try to finish the game out with a huge board.
I think if I were Life Coach, I would be keeping the Violet Teacher in the prep. But he looks at the fan of knives in the prep. I mean, what could be better than a turn 3 coin Violet Teacher prep? But Tom just draws completely dead. Abusive Sergeant Wolfire. Iron Big Owl.
That is as bad as it can possibly get. You are absolutely correct there. But, I mean, he might just have to play the Ironbeak Owl on turn 2 and just start getting, minions onto the board. Of course, Life Coach would love to see that with his prep fan, but obviously would be a bit painful pill for Tom to swallow. Could be just a hero power as well. As far as life coach goes, we could see him rogue on turn one once more. Obviously, I mean, he hasn't played rogue too much, and this is a very complicated deck to pilot. So it'll be interesting to see if he goes for the coin hero power or if he just passes here. Either way, he's taking a bit of damage.
Yeah, I think without the fan, you would want to be looking at coin hero power. But with the fan, I feel like not going for the hero power is the correct call.
Yeah, definitely could be something he'd look at. And even pick up the second prep, so that could, fuel him later in the game, using the prep fan to clear the board and then maybe a prep Tinker's Oil later on in the game. That's probably, I mean, all these thoughts are probably going through Life Coach's head at the moment. We'll see which one he goes with. But in the end, I imagine he just passes here.
Yeah, seems to be there. I have to agree with Life Coach here, but now what does Tom do? Goes with the hero power, but what could it be silencing? There is the Edwin, possibly.
Yeah,
There's the Edwin and the Paladin Sweater, but I.
there's a Sludge
Or a Boom
Belcher.
Bot. Yeah, Belcher, sure, okay.
Yeah,
I don't
that's
know,
the
it's a, so,
thing.
such a low amount of minions, though, compared to what you see out of maybe a Paladin or something like that. I mean, the Belcher is still a problem, it still will train into a lot of things, so. You need to have an overwhelming board to be able to go for something like that. But I just worry for Tom. It looks like he's probably going to go for the Wolfire on the following turn, and when the prep comes out, what can he really do?
Yeah, definitely. Though Life Coach, I mean, what does Life Coach do here on the other hand? I mean, if he hero powers and doesn't attack into the Abusive Sergeant, that's basically giving away what he has in his hand. And if he does kill the Abusive Sergeant, it makes the Phantom Knives less, important in the following turn. The other option he could have gone with is a coin Earthring Farseer for the full healing, excuse me. And from there would be able, to play the Phantom of the following turn perhaps. And maybe picks up something to play on turn four, but looks like he's gonna want to play the Earthring Farseer on curve, and then maybe coin into that Belcher, and that's why he went for that play. I imagine he just has to go for the fan here, though. Otherwise, he's taking way too much damage.
What about prepping fan right now? I see it does have
Yeah,
two
I think
preparations. I feel like that's stronger.
that's what I meant. I go for the prep fan as well as the Earthring Farseer to develop the board. But yeah, I do think he has to fan here to prevent, further damage. I don't think he can face tank this one.
Have to agree with you there, but things are looking better for Tom with that bow. Without the bow, looking at a turn four Arcane Golem, that would just be almost impossible to come back from. The thing is, you give I've got so much more momentum. We saw that before today with when Colento just demolished Dog, and the main thing behind that was that the Dog went for the Arcane Golem, and the mana, the one extra mana, it just gave Colento the win there.
Yeah, definitely. In that case, though, we did have the Healbot for Kalento in that situation, so it was a bit different. Tom now deciding whether or not to hit the face or hit this Earthenring Farseer. I mean, both are pretty viable. I know a lot of face hunters like to just hit the face and, worry about it later, or not worry about it at all, actually. But in this situation, if Tom clears this Earthenring Farseer, I mean, strangely enough, the longer this game goes, the more it favors Tom because he has that constant of the hero power killing Life Coach, slowly to death. Whereas, if he leaves that minion up, Tom could be taking a lot of damage from something like a prep oil. So definitely not the easiest turn for Tom here, and has to consider, how long it's going to take Tom in order to kill Life Coach, whether he goes for the kill here or not.
That is true. I think, if you're trading now, you're not going to get probably a lot of value out of the Unleash the Hounds. It's such a late game card. I think it may end up being the right call to trade, though, but it's painful. Because you're taking 3 damage per turn. This Earth Ring might be 9 damage in the grand scheme of things if he gets to attack a few times over, but oh, he gets the
Ooh.
Edwin! Wow. There's no
Yeah.
good prep target, though. Couldn't he just coin Belcher now and take it from there? I think that's probably going to be stronger.
Yeah, what do you value more, having the Belcher to stand in the way or having a huge Edwin? And that could decide what Life Coach decides to go for here. I mean, if he wants to, whatever he wants to get silence, assuming that there's some sort of silence in Tom's hand, he will probably go for that. So yeah, could see the Belcher here, and we will have pretty much a guaranteed 6-6 if I enclave the next turn because of that prep in hand. So yeah, let's see what he goes for. Seems pretty weak to go for an Eviscerate to face, though that might be where it goes in the future anyway. But yeah, gonna go for the Belcher. Imagine we're going to see an Owl out of Tom, and that will be the green light for Life Coach to go for a huge Edwin Van Cleef.
I think so, yeah. And it may be time for the Arcane Golem even, but the Juggler with the Unleash seems strong, and I think Tom's definitely not regretting having gone for that bolt to the face. I feel like he may even have to continue that trend here. Now there's no fan to save Life Coach. This is getting really exciting.
Yeah, absolutely. Every single turn here is just so nail-biting. And typically, you don't think about that for the face hunter. You know, it seems like so, you know, one-dimensional. Just hit the face all the time. But there are so many decisions to be made, particularly in this situation. Tom has to think about everything that Life Coach could possibly do from this turn on out. But in the end, we could see him just hit the face and maybe even hero power. Just try to get that steady damage in. Obviously, he has the bow to re-equip.
It's true here, yeah. It's hard to tell. Tom is very cautious. He really doesn't want to give Life Coach the extra mana. Also feels that he may run out of steam soon, but it's fate now. Interesting.
Goes for the trade, and that's some damage on Tom, and you know, no damage to face, obviously, making that play. And Life Coach, let's see what he does here. Can go... He cannot play the Deadly Poison right now. I mean, he can, but he can't go for, the Deadly Poison plus Eviscerate and play the Edwin, because obviously, you know, you need a dagger for that to apply.
I kind of like Hero Power, then going prep Eviscerate to the face, going for 6-6 Edwin and clearing the Owl. That's what I really like in this position. He has 17 health to go for, puts Tom, what is that, down to 16, has a 6-6 and a 3-5, and he's just ahead in that case.
Yeah, definitely. And I think Life Coach is probably going to go for that play that you mentioned. He's just deciding whether or not to eviscerate the Owl or to eviscerate the face here. And it is a definite, it's a big decision, obviously, because you get closer to killing your opponent if you eviscerate face. But, you know, obviously taking that extra 2 damage can be pretty painful. Looks like he is going to go for that play. Going to go for the eviscerate on the Owl. Going to play it safe. Also going to obviously play out that Edwin Van Cleef that can be so devastating to Tom right here. And let's see Tom's reaction. Not much of one, obviously, realizing that everything is possible in the situation. And especially after that prep came out. But yeah.
He may be thinking, yeah, that the weapon is damaged as well. So he takes 2 less damage and maybe deals 2 more or even 3 more damage by having a second charge on the Deadly Poison. So that may be what Life Coach is thinking. It's a good point, yeah. It definitely depends on what he top decks here to follow it up. Yeah, I feel like, though, Tom is in a bit of a hurry, honestly. Like, this wasn't an obvious choice by any means. I feel like if he was going to go for either Juggler or Unleash, or possibly even the Animal Companion, he would want to see the RNG before looking at the bow.
Yeah, definitely. But definitely a hard turn for Tom. He could go for the 1-3 Huffer right now, could go for the guaranteed Arcane Golem to the face, but obviously that gives your opponent 7 mana for the following turn, which can be dangerous. And we do see in Life Coach's hand that he can't really do too much with that 7 mana, obviously not going to be sprinting in this situation. But Tom with a very tough decision, and maybe he's just summoning the will to draw to get the Huffer, but no, it's going to be the Arcane Golem. And Life Coach now down to 12 and facing a guaranteed, you know, 5 damage from from Tom on board.
Yeah, this seems actually to be an easy turn, I think. But Life Coach is, if we know him correctly, he's going to take the entire turn. But I feel like in this case, you have to trade into the Arcane Golem. And I like Acid Rake and Deadly Poison here as the follow-up. You may just check what you get from the Acid Rake. Maybe you get a backstab and then that's going to be stronger. Well, something you'd want to add in even, but is there any merit to sprint here?
Yeah, I don't think there's any world in which you sprint here. I think you get the Azure Drake on the field, and I think you do that right away just to see what you can draw here. And, you know, if you can draw maybe that backstab, like you say, this is kind of bizarre to me seeing the Sludge Belcher go in right away, especially because he could draw that backstab. I'm wondering what he's thinking right here.
Yeah, this is confusing to me. Oh, he's playing around at least the Hound.
Oh,
because
right,
he has to be lethal anyway. But
then he ends up going for it anyway. Huh? This is kind of strange. Doesn't get the backstab anyway, so doesn't make a huge difference in the end. Is there any way for Tom to win this game right here with a Huffer draw? Obviously, he has the five
If
from
all
his.
three go to face, it's going to be 8 damage now. Huffer plus what? No, I can't see any way for this to work out.
The
I think there's
most
no
damage
way.
I can see right now
It's
is.
8 if all jugglers go to face, that's 8.
Oh, 8 damage, right. And yeah, 8. So yeah, 3 from the knives and 3 from the hounds and then 2 from the hero power. So that would be the perfect, RNG situation, but it wouldn't be enough. With the Huffer and Glaive Zooka as well as a hero power, that would also not be enough. Only 7 damage in that situation. I could go for the Nitro in this situation as well, but definitely a tough situation for Tom deciding what to go for here. And he's basically dead on board, so I feel like he has to go for this Nitro to unleash here.
He hits all three to the Acid Drake and the Belt Shield. There is a possibility for him to clear the Acid Drake. Something to consider, maybe.
Oh, gets one on the Azure Drake, which is pretty big here. Oh no. Oh, okay, never mind. He got the Glaive Zooka on the Nightshade. I was a bit confused there for a second. But yeah, gonna be able to clear the board and stay alive for one more turn, at least on board. 9 damage from Life Coach, and just any damage will do here. Just needs two.
Is he gonna go for the fan? I imagine he would backstab first, wouldn't he?
Yeah, most likely. I mean, he doesn't have. There's no preps left in the deck, by the way. He's used both. We've already seen both, so he can't go for sprint here. Because that wouldn't allow. I mean, he could draw a deadly poison. Has he used both deadly poisons yet?
Believe he's only used one. He doesn't want to use a Vile Teacher, definitely because of the threat of Unleash. He wants to
Right.
go face with the Edwin, and he can do that with the backstab, so there's no reason not to use the backstab right now, that I can see at least. But Fan just gives you a better chance of lethal, I feel. Because, I mean, even Deadly Poison wouldn't be lethal here.
Yeah, so he does go for the backstab. We'll see if he goes for the fan or the sprint. Goes for the fan. Can he draw 2 damage right here? It's going to be the sap. Not going to be enough. Does he play the Violet Teacher just in case something happens to his Edwin? I guess it doesn't really matter too much either way. But Tom, unless he top decks something, needs to pick up Huffer here to have lethal.
1 in 3, or maybe a kill command, yeah? Kill command or quick shot, but
That's not gonna
oof,
be it.
seems like
Has
it's
to
just
draw
gonna
the
be a
1 in
1 in
3 right
3.
here, or else it's over. Gets the
Oh my
Huffer! And
god!
Tom is still alive! Oh my goodness! That is an amazing roll onto that Huffer, and he is just exhausted. Realizes that that was it for him if he didn't draw that. And Tom is going to bring it back to 1-2 and is still alive in this series. I can't believe that just happened.
I think Lavcoach's expression after that happened was just priceless. He looked so confused in the end, and I don't blame him. I mean, getting that 1 in 3, it just really sucks because Lavcoach played that game so well. But I mean, Thomas had a fantastic tournament though, and he shouldn't be counted out. He has now to follow this up, the freeze mage and then the rogue mirror. And I mean, anything can happen absolutely in the rogue mirror. And the freeze mage can go either way as well. I feel like the freeze mage is even favored against the rogue if you don't have the assassin's blade as the rogue.
Yeah, absolutely. So this will be really interesting going forward. That was the crucial game for Tom to win, obviously. I mean, going in, he knew that he was favored, but with the double preps that Life Coach had, he was also close to taking that, came right down to the wire, and even having to draw the right animal companion in that situation. I think Life Coach's best chance remaining is to beat Tom's rogue. I don't think he has a very great chance against the mage of Tom, especially considering that there's a Reno Jackson in there.
I still agree with you there. I mean, but it just depends. The scenario where you do beat the freeze mage is where they just run out of draw early on, and you get maybe a 3-drop into a 4-drop into a low step into burst. That can happen, but obviously Reno on its own, you need to draw a lot of cards to be able to just to use him. Generally, at least 5 or 6, because the secrets are usually you play 2 of the secrets. So that may not happen until turn 8 or 9, and it's possible to die before that happens.
Yeah, definitely. We saw that earlier in the tournament when Eloise faced off against Gwolliver, and it was one of the saddest sights you will ever see. The Reno Jackson Freeze Mage basically lost 3 games in a row in that situation. And every single time, Fueller was unable to get the requisite parts to be able to activate Reno Jax in the first two games, no Frost Nova the entire time, and finally in the third game, I believe he was missing a Frostbolt or an Ice Lance, but it was very sad to see him, you know, hope that he made a mistake in counting, and with no other options left, play the Reno to no effect. It was a pretty sad sight to see, but in this game right now, Life Coach has a kind of a reasonable hand. You do want to see minions early on, and then kind of go from there into your burst to be able to just kill the freeze mage as quickly as possible. By the way, Life Coach does know that Tom is running Reno Jax, and so that's going to be informing his decisions in this game. As far as Tom goes, obviously going to be wanting as much card draw as possible. Was thinking about tossing the Acolyte, but in the end, just keeps it in his hand, and there's the Reno Jax.
So generally in this deck, you have two Ice Lances, two Frostbolts, two Arcane Intellects, two Mad Scientists, and double Secrets here. So he has one out of the way, at least. I guess there's, what, five more to go? So it may be even possible by turn six that he can pay the Reno Jackson, but I mean, is he going to even... Yeah, absolutely. That's how you got to do. And so important to actually be counting, because it does happen sometimes that people miscount and don't heal at all.
Yeah, I believe that Tom will be laser focused on all the cards that he draws here. Especially important that he makes sure that Reno goes off, obviously. But Life Coach, again, going to do his best job to focus here on turn one, make sure he gets all the right plays going forward. We can see that he can't really do anything. Obviously, he's not going to be coining hero powering in this matchup. But yeah, just taking as much time as possible. And actually, that Frost Nova was a very big draw. That's one of the parts that's in Tom's deck that is a duplicate. So that's one thing. That's one less thing he has to draw in order to activate Reno.
Yeah, the ice block as well. So we're looking good on that. Making good progress here. So yeah, first bolt Ice Lance, Ice Barrier, Mad Scientist. And,
right. Yeah. And even with the Mad Scientist, if he draws that card, maybe he can draw the Ice Barrier out of his deck as well. So that'll be crucial going forward to see how that pairs out. And Life Coach, again, taking his time. Gonna go with the Dagger here. Had a few options whether or not he wanted to go with the Coin, Edwin, or just play the Thanos as well. But having options going forward, doesn't really need to play the Thanos right now. Tom just going to go ahead and play that Acolyte of Pain. And this is why he kept the Acolyte of Pain in his opening hand, rather than, you know, relying on that Arcane Intellect, because this can slow down Life Coach, as you see his expression. Doesn't know how to deal with this quite yet. And yeah, it just basically slows down the Oil Rogue and makes him kind of deal with it. Though, you know, Life Coach could just ignore this and play his Violet Teacher.
It's not too bad at all. Does give the option for Tom to just ping the Acolyte and guarantee a double draw, but if he's only getting two draws out of this, then it's essentially a five mana Arcane Intellect.
Yeah, exactly. And there's no real way for Life Coach to deal with it anyway. He could SI7 agent by throwing away the coin here and then using his dagger, but that's the exact same thing as allowing Tom to draw via his ping anyway. And in this situation where you make ping or make Tom use the ping, you're obviously, you know, forcing him to use two mana. So I like this play by Life Coach. Just going to ignore it for one turn and take it out later.
But now, yeah, the Ice Lance is out. So this is getting closer and closer to that Reno Jackson turn. But Tom is going to be pinging this. Gets the Doomsayer on top of that. Yeah, oof. Could that even be playable right now?
Yeah, I was looking at that for a second there, but it's pretty risky, especially because there's already 3 damage on the board to be able to take that out. And, just taking it out right away for Life Coach would be a huge risk for Tom. The one upside, kind of, is that if he does play it, looks like he is going to play it. I mean, obviously that Frost Nova Doomsayer is one of the best options you have to, you know, deal with any sort of board. But, you know, there are options like the Sap and the Rogue to deal with it. But one thing to consider in this particular situation is that if Life Coach uses spells to deal with this, then it creates 1/1s. And those 1/1s can be used for Tom to draw more cards off of his Acolyte. So it could be a kind of a next level play here.
Yeah, also if he gets sapped, then there's no harm, no foul. He was debating doing nothing or playing the Doomsayer, and if it baits the Sap, and that's fantastic. I think also it's nice for him not to trade into the Wild Teacher, because first of all, it means the Life Coach can't go face, and second of all, there's a possibility of now that he will draw, yeah, as you say, a card, but this is what going for the eviscerate. We'll also have to attack with the Vile Teacher. This is fantastic for Tom.
Yeah, again, showing really kind of next level thinking here, realizing that if that spell came out, it's going to make a 1/1, and that, enables Tom to draw a bit more. And let's see, is he close to overdrawing if he plays this Arcane Intellect? He will draw two more cards, which would bring him to 8 cards. If he draws with the Acolyte, it brings him to 9, and then 10, I believe, before if Life Coach decides to kill off the Acolyte. So this will be pretty interesting to see what he goes for. Yeah, he needs
He
to.
may have to use the Frostbolt in the end if he doesn't draw a Mad Scientist. So that may be the scenario that he's looking at. It's not horrible to use the Frostbolt. It sets up for a pretty good Blizzard next turn.
Yeah, he could also go for the Frostwald Iceland just to take care of this Vile Teacher right away before it causes any problems. Obviously, he has the Blizzard, but there's limited amount of freeze in this Reno Jackson Freeze Mage because obviously you want to be cutting some of those cards to enable to rec to excuse me enable the Reno Jackson to go off. Another option here could be that Ice Block and just ping, and that would enable you to get all the cards out of your Acolyte and maybe use the Arcane Intellect at a future date.
I think I'll be looking at like Intellect and Frostbolt here, no question. I mean, Mad Scientist if you get it though. I feel like Ice Block ping is too slow, but that's just my opinion
Oh.
there. That's not good at all. This is a mistake.
Yeah, he's guaranteed going to overdraw here, and I imagine Life Coach is going to take that out with his face. Life Coach probably not going to miss this opportunity. Even has, I believe, the mana, as we see the Rocket Chart kind of covering up our vision here, but yeah, has the mana to go for the Azure Drake now and curve out really well. Interesting play by Tom, because he just wanted to draw as many cards as possible. I mean, the one benefit is that the more cards he draws here, the more he gets closer to being able to play that Reno, though. Where I think all he needs is Ice Barrier at this point.
Yeah, Tom just looks tired, honestly, and there was no reason to not draw first. It's something, that you learn at rank 5, and Tom certainly knows here. Now, he will overdraw, but what will he discard? That will be so important. At least now, there's only the Mad Scientist left, and then he can play the Reno
Right.
Jackson. Not that he needs to right now, but he can at least go for a 9-card Emperor Torsion next turn. That looks pretty good.
Yeah, that may be what he was thinking. He's just gonna risk overdrawing here and get as much value as he can out of the Emperor Thorsen. Ice Spear is not too bad to discard, honestly. I mean, obviously it can be nice to heal up against the rogue, but on the other hand, getting a lot of value out of this Emperor Thorsen. So, I mean, as much as we might like to call it a misplay, I mean, maybe Tom is just taking a huge gamble here, throwing away a card that could potentially be useless depending on what it is, and getting as much value as possible out of this Emperor Thorsen.
I think though, this could have been Alexstrasza, this could have been Fireball, this could have been Flamestrike or Antonida. So this was crazy risk that he really didn't need to take. And also now he has two Mad Scientists left and only one secret. So he might even draw the second Ice Block, and then the Mad Scientist will just be useless. So this is just worse in every way here. But Life Coach, what can he do? I really like the idea of possibly saving Lothep here. I don't think he needs to go for that right now.
Yeah, in particular, if he goes for Lothep, he knows that there is a 7 mana Frost Nova potentially coming out. What do you think about sapping here and just discarding another card here for Tom?
I like it. I really like it here. But he could go for a SI as well, and an Edwin. Well, what are you looking at here?
Yeah, it looks like he is fav. Oh, he can go for both actually. He's gonna go for the SI7 and the Edwin here and just get as big a board as possible, realizing that his opponent's drawn a ton of cards and the Reno could be a possibility at any time. So gonna put on the aggression here. Gonna put Tom down to 18 health.
Also, yeah,
Wow,
the
over.
overdraw on top of that. Yeah, but that was
Wow.
a fantastic thing to overdraw the Arcane Intellect.
Yeah, that was the best card for Tom to overdraw basically. And now what does Tom do here? He has a lot of options actually. He can go for the Blizzard, can go for the Frost Nova, though I imagine you'd want to save that for when Lothep comes out. But yeah, what are the options here? I guess maybe you could just go for the Blizzard plus the
Ice
Ice
Barrier?
Barrier, yeah.
Yeah. It's not too bad. I mean, he may also be looking at something.
Mike
Go for the
looks like he's playing.
Haze.
Yeah, okay, I guess he can't really afford to wait for something like a Doomsayer, and even in that case it could get removed, so gonna try to finish this off the, you know, the good old-fashioned way through just damage and use that Ice Lance, and realizes that now that he's had 7 cards, it's going to take a bit of effort for Life Coach to make Tom overdraw here, so makes sense to just play out the Acolyte.
But will he sap the Acolyte? I think that's the big question. There seems to be no reason not to go for the low step now, because if Tom has a Frost Nova, then it's at least wasted, and if he doesn't have a Frost Nova, then Life Coach wins the whole tournament.
Yeah, exactly. What do you think about the placement here? Going to put it right next to the Edwin Van Cleef, which is not the greatest for Kona Cold. Typically, you like to separate your bigger minions. But Life Coach has a decision to make whether or not he wants to sap this, or if he wants to go for a dagger here. Obviously, you know, using your second sap can be pretty dangerous, especially with all the minions that are coming out of Tom. So here, from Tom's perspective, he can play the Frost Nova. Obviously, it's too dangerous to go back with the Emperor Thorsten, so that's going to be the play. And pretty much no way for Tom to die from this situation, so pretty safe.
I think so, yeah. Yes, at least Life Coach does have the oil, which is important. I'd be surprised if he went for the Dr. Boom. It doesn't seem strong here. Now, how is the sap going to come into play, or could he look at something like Sprint?
I like the backstab now that he has the... I mean, he picked up that backstab, and he has the spell damage on board, so I think I'm okay with that. The only problem with backstab is it makes potentially too many 1-1s on the board here, especially if he goes for Sprint and the backstab, and I won't be able to play anything else on the board. Though Tom is pretty anxious to get rid of this board anyway, so maybe you just kind of fill it up.
Yeah, an important note, though, that Tom hasn't drawn the Flamestack yet, so he doesn't have a way to clear this. I mean, even if he has the Doomsayer next turn, it won't be enough. And with both Acolytes gone, or one of them here in hand, they may need to be replayed. I don't see how he can actually clear this. A Cone of Cold has to be the best way for him to at least, you know, slow this down. But I don't really know about this. This is looking rough.
Yeah, the Life Coach is actually thinking about this Dr. Boom, surprisingly enough. Only would get one Boombot out of it in that situation. I kind of like to see the Sprint and the backside. I think there's already enough pressure onto the board. And going to play again on the left side, which, I mean, obviously there's the Boombot there, which, you know, has to be pinged off first if Tom does want to go for the Kona Cold on the Lothab, Van Cleef, and the Dr. Boom. But I don't know. I don't like the placement. The greatest here from Life Coach. Maybe a bit of, you know, inexperience playing this rogue deck, but at least from Tom's perspective, what can he do here? Obviously, he's pretty safe from dying with double ice block in hand, but needs to make something happen over the next few turns to clear this board.
Yeah, probably going to be looking at Cone of Cold. I would think he'd want to use the ping first, get rid of the Boombot, and take off all three big minions. Now, that's 5 mana, and he has 4 to follow it up. Would maybe Frostbolt, and on the follow-up with that, would he go for Ice Barrier or Ice Block? Like, Ice Barrier is safe.
Yeah, Ice Barrier could be safe. One thing to keep in mind in this matchup overall is that Tom doesn't need to save any burst, honestly, because it's not like he's playing against Druid or something like that. Doesn't need to kill his opponent. He just has to need... Wow, he's actually going to go for the Thorsten and the Ice Block. Very ballsy play here, especially because that Boombot represents potential lethal if... Tom isn't able to deal with it right away.
I mean, he figures he has Reno, so
right.
He still can't slow down the board enough.
Yeah, this is really risky here from Tom.
But I kind of like it, though.
Yeah, Tom has, up to this point, just shown that he's willing to take any and all risk. We saw him take down a Control Warrior with Control Priest earlier on turn 8. So that's the kind of risk that Tom likes to take. Just, you know, throwing caution to the wind, playing the brawls. And this case, really just kind of cheating death in a way, you know, with such a huge board on the side of Life Coach.
Now, I imagine he's going to be trading into the Thoris and not letting him be sapped, but if that's the case, would there maybe be any merit to attacking with SI first and getting a 1-1 on the board? Or is that just going to be in the way?
Yeah, I think 1-1s might be in the way. It doesn't really need to go for that, but I believe Life Coach can pop this and deal with this Thorsten at the same time. So yeah, not too big a deal for Life Coach. So I mentioned that Life Coach or Tom doesn't need to burn out his opponent. He can basically just stay alive and run the rogue out of damage. Flamestrike is. See, this is the kind of the issue I had with the last turn because I felt like he had to get rid of that boom bot before he went for that kind of play. He cannot Flamestrike here or else he dies, even if he plays the ice block, so this is kind of an issue.
He just can't go for the same play with Reno. But wait, there's no mad scientist. Did he maybe just
Oh,
miscalculate?
right. He hasn't drawn a mad scientist yet. So he's drawn
Wow.
every single other card, but no mad scientist. You see him hovering over his deck. He hasn't drawn the mad scientist. Usually, that's one of the earliest cards you see because obviously it's one of the early game pieces that you can have. But wow, he hasn't drawn the mad scientist. You're right.
Could he be figuring that out right now? Because he was playing like he was going to Reno next turn.
Yeah, definitely. But even if he Renos, I mean, he still has to use Kona Cold.
Mean, he can't Reno. He'll die. Like
Yeah,
it's tough.
exactly. But I mean, he can't even kill the Boom Bot, honestly, because he's gonna die, obviously. But yeah, looks like he's just gonna kill off this Dr. Boom, and gonna set up the ice barrier as well. I think you just use this Ice Lance, right? Just because you need to start clearing out these minions, and you're just trying to stay alive here. That is a win condition for this deck, just to stay alive against the Oil Rogue, because you
An
can run him out
important
of
thing now,
damage.
though, an
Yeah.
important thing now though is that Life Coach has the can pop it, but he will have to backstab his own boom bot here to have that happen.
Yeah, but do you go for that? Because that boom bot is such a threat right now for Tom. I mean, he can never clear it. Tom can never clear it on his own turn. So maybe you go for something else here. I mean, a deadly poison plus Tinkers is 6 damage, obviously. So that wouldn't be enough since your opponent is at 9 right now, essentially. You could try to go for the 1 and 3 onto the boom bot with the Tinkers and try to set that up.
What about the starting off with the acid trick? See what you get. It's gonna
Oh,
go. Oh,
gets
he
it
hits
onto
the
the boom
boom
bot.
bot.
So now he can pop the block and leave the boom bot on the table, which is obviously super threatening for Tom. He's actually going to go with the Azure Drake afterward. And the reason why he went for that first is because he wanted to guarantee, or not guarantee, but get a higher chance of having the Tinkers go on the boom bot. But this is such a dire situation for Tom. And Life Coach is going to just fill out the board so that we don't see any sort of Reno craziness. There's a mad
He gets so
scientist. Is
much
that
scientist.
enough?
Oh my god.
That is the last piece, right? He can just play Reno here.
He can, yeah. He
All right,
can
so we
tap.
believe he can play Reno. Looks like that is going to be it. And let's see Life Coach's reaction right now. I guess maybe his webcam is a bit stuck, but that might have just saved Tom the game and the series.
But still, I mean, where did Tom go from here? He's discarded all of his draw. Or he lost at least the arcane intellect. He's used both of the Acolytes of Pain or the Acolyte of Pain. He can't really be, improving his hand that much. He'll be drawing one card a turn, and even though he's at full health with two armor, won't he just die to the minions?
I mean, he could, but if he can somehow find a way to clear Life Coach's board, and he does have the Flamestrike, I mean, there's limited damage left in Life Coach's deck. He's running out of cards as well.
Yeah, I feel like Life Coach should probably look at saving maybe the saving the SI. It's obviously very hard for him to call his opponent having a flame strike, but is there any need to? Maybe just hero power up.
Yeah, on the one hand, it's pretty tough. I mean, you might. If you commit to the SI, it's really weak against Flamestrike, but maybe you commit before your opponent draws Flamestrike, is what he's thinking.
That is true, yeah. It's a very good point. I'm impressed by Life Coach though this game. I really, really am. I think he went for the correct play on the tough turn with that. But is he gonna ping? Oh, he's just gonna
That's
clear right
actually
there.
a really good draw right here. This Boombot could hit the Thalnos, does hit the Thalnos, so now
Hits the
Tom has drawn an
Thalnos.
extra card and is able to clear this board pretty well here, but yeah, like you said, still there's damage coming out of Life Coach. He still has minions for that repeated damage, and I imagine he's gonna go for that rather than go for the sprint here. He can just go for that next turn. Gonna get these
Now, I
two
want to
minions on
mention
board.
something though, like when Tom was in the position where he did discard unnecessarily, he discarded a Frost Nova. No,
An
an
ice
ice barrier,
barrier,
I mean,
right?
yeah, so he could be at 21 health right now, and that might actually make all of the difference.
Ooh, Mad Scientist is not what you want to see. 6 cards left, 7 cards left for Life Coach. And yeah, like you say, I mean, that was such a lifesaver getting that mad scientist, but right now it just looks so bleak again.
Yeah, I mean, I think you might want to ping the SI. I think it's the most.
Yeah, most likely, right?
Still, I mean, does Tom even have the resources to kill Erko to this point? He's used,
Right, I
what
mean.
is it, at least two ice lances, Frostbolt, Firebolt, all for removal. So he has. Do you know if he has a Pyroblast? It's a tough situation. I mean, a lot of people are cutting
Yeah,
Pyroblast right
it's
now.
pretty hard to fit its Pyroblast in there, but yeah, you're right. What if Life Coach just elects not to draw cards here and goes for the fatigue battle? But I don't know if that's a viable option for him.
He really doesn't need to. There's no need to take that risk. He can just play this safe and start drawing.
So what do you think about after he sprints here, sapping out this Dooms here to get an extra to get the extra damage to face?
It depends a bit on the hand.
Is that lethal? 7, 8, and then he has 6
14, yeah, it's
remaining. That
lethal.
is lethal. That is going to be it. Life Coach is going to be your champion of the Celestial Invitational through an extremely difficult field and being able to navigate all 9 decks throughout this tournament. That is going to be it. I am so excited. That was just amazing.
Beautiful play by Life Coach game after game, and I really can't give enough credit to have evolved. He was bringing the old decks though, but he just proved that he knows Hearthstone and he knows the strategy involved in this game. Even though he may not have played the highest amount of Rogue, he's still winning a tournament, a major event here with a class he's almost never played. So it's very impressive. Tom though, making it through all of the Chinese players here, getting second place, a lot of respect to him as well.
Yeah, exactly. You see the bracket right there. Life Coach going through a murderer's row of opponents, Eloise, Kalento, and Tom, who was absolutely on fire coming into this tournament. So well played by Life Coach. And one thing I want to point out, Life Coach, I mean, sometimes he's the butt of the joke, right? You know, Rope Coach taking so much time in every single turn, but in this case, it helped him so much, even with these decks that he hasn't been too familiar with, just thinking out all the possibilities of every single turn and thinking about every single thing that could happen helped him so much over the course of these games. And even in this last game, in an unfavored matchup, he was able to take it down with the Oil Rogue.
Really impressive stuff here. I mean, China had its representatives though, Eloise making it far. We had two Chinese qualified players, Jaysha and Braros making to the round of 8 as well. I mean, Jaysha even making it to the round of 4 here. So very impressive showing by the Eastern scene and the Western scene. Life Coach takes the in the end. I mean, we had 6 players come through, even actually 7 out of 8 coming through here as an invite. So we're joking about, you know, Celestial possibly doing a too good of a job inviting players. But yeah, fantastic tournament. And Life Coach goes home with $10,000, Tom $5,000 for second place, and then Colento and Jaysha go home with 2.5 grand.
Yeah, exactly. As well as the $1,205.50, excuse me, for the rest of our top 8. I mean, I guess as we kind of wind down here at the end of the tournament, we can kind of recap what happened. The round of 8, a bunch of 3-0s. I mean, who was expecting that after, you know, it barely happened in the group stages? Looks like we're finally wrapping up here. I guess any last words about this tournament in general?
I'm just really excited to see more tournaments out of China. It's very interesting, their meta game. They seem to be more heavily focused on Control Priest, for example. They haven't been picking up the aggro Druid, so it'll be interesting to see if they do, and or if they just think that the more mid-range Druid is better. It's at least my opinion. It's interesting to see people playing Shaman. I love this format where you have to play all 9 classes. It really punishes the players that are just stuck on few classes or maybe, you know, only 3 classes, and it rewards the players that have put in the time and played this game for a long time. So just a fantastic tournament, and I can't wait for the next one.
Yeah, absolutely. Me neither. I am definitely looking forward to Celestial Invitational number 2. Even those qualifiers were amazing to cast coming into this tournament. Probably not many of you were able to watch that, but they were great as well. And yeah, just winding down, thanks to everyone for watching. Thank you, Kaldi, for being my co-caster. Thank you to Monk in the first couple of days for being there as well. And yeah, again, we will see you guys at some point. Again, I am D2. Our casters this tournament were myself, Kaldi, and Monk. And I guess thanks to Sin as well. Who are we forgetting, Kaldi? Who are we forgetting to thank?
I guess just maybe Team Celestial and the producers here, Sintan, for example. But yeah, you guys should definitely go ahead and follow D2 on his Twitter if you want to promote that.
Yeah, it's D2HS, so go click that follow button. I would love to see every single follow, but
Could also check out Tembo Kaldi. I just did 2K today, so it'd be really good to get that rolling. I'll be streaming tomorrow at least. I know that on my channel, Kaldi TV. Get to check that out and make sure to check out more Chinese tournaments. We had, I believe it was $75,000 tournament here last week, and that barely got any coverage. So if you want to see some high level Hearthstone, the Chinese scene is the scene to look out for.
Yeah, definitely. So much prize money going on in the Chinese Hearthstone scene. We have extended, we've overstayed our welcome, it seems. It looks like the stream is already over for the Chinese site DouYu TV. So, yeah, again, thank you, everyone. I guess thank you, TempleStorm, as well, for allowing us to stream on their channel. And thank you to Celestial. And we are out, guys. Good night.